Welcome to the Eating Disorder Recovery Podcast.
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 Welcome to the Eating Disorder Recovery Podcast with me, Dr. Janine Anderson. Heads up, this show may contain adult language and may mention specific foods. If you find either of those to be too triggering, I trust you to take care of yourself and do what you need to do. This podcast is sponsored by ED Care. ED Care has provided PHP, IOP, and outpatient treatment for all genders 18 and over since 2001. CAMHSA, which stands for Connection, Acceptance, Mindfulness, Sense of Self, and Action, is ED Care's mindfulness-based treatment approach and is incorporated into each individualized treatment plan. Facilities are located in Denver, Colorado Springs, and Kansas City, and all treatment is supported by master's-level clinicians or higher. ED Care offers four specialty tracks for binge eating disorder, elite athletes, substance use, and trauma. And the Connections House and affordable, supportive housing component adds an extra layer of supervised support. Visit eatingdisorder.care or call 866-771-0861. Hi, friends. Today, we are going to talk about the idea of intuitive movement and exercise. So one of the things I wanted to start by saying is that not everybody likes the term exercise, and people have different ideas about how we should talk about movement versus exercise. So I am not totally abandoning the term exercise. I generally do say movement and try to get people to think about the idea of movement more broadly than the idea of exercise, which I think of as specifically setting out to have some physical exertion, and really just moving your body in general has a lot of health benefits. In fact, just reducing the amount of time that your body is sitting or completely sedentary has some health benefits. So I wanted to give that caveat, first of all. Also wanted to point out that, of course, there are all different kinds of reasons why people's ability to be physically active or to move in the ways that they want can be limited. And there's no judgment toward that. I acknowledge that I have a lot of privilege that my body generally doesn't have too many limitations on how it can move, except for some very minor stuff. So in comparison to other people, I certainly would identify as having a lot of able body privilege for sure. Okay, so let's get into it, because I get tons of questions about this. And I definitely talk with my own clients about this as well. So the first thing to think about with intuitive movement and exercise, and we will talk a lot more about how this can map onto the concepts that you know from intuitive eating. I will cover that in just a minute, is that you need to listen to your treatment team. So just like all other episodes of this podcast, if I ever say something that contradicts what your treatment team is recommending, you need to listen to your treatment team. Because I'm just sitting here in my office in Denver recording this, not knowing your individual circumstance, and certainly not providing any advice on exactly what you need to do. But instead, I'm covering just kind of general concepts for people to think about in their recovery. I would also encourage you that if you've started listening to this episode and you know that you're in a place in your recovery journey where maybe you don't need to be thinking about exercise, you don't need to be reminded that there are health benefits to exercise, maybe stop listening and revisit this at a later time, or save it. Listen to it with your treatment team or your therapist. I don't mean for this to be triggering to anybody. I just wanted to cover this topic because it is important. But also know, if you're not in a good space to be thinking about this and you're going to find it triggering, your eating disorder is going to latch onto it, then skip this one. No big deal. There are other episodes for you to listen to. So that's the first major big thing, is always listen to your treatment team, not only about whether you need to be doing exercise or not, but just in general to kind of get some helpful outside perspective. And I do not think that this is disempowering or abdicating all of your power as a person, but just seeking some counsel and getting some perspective, because we know how sneaky the eating disorder can be in making you think like, oh no, I can totally do exercise in this way that's not self-destructive. And then you report back to your therapist and your therapist is like, no, that's totally screwed up. Did you hear what you just said? So always listen to your treatment team. Only exercise or do any kind of physical movement when It's advised that you do so when you feel like you're ready to do so, when you and your treatment providers have come to that decision mutually and collaboratively. The second point I want to make about exercise and movement is that in my clinical experience, people really want to rush this step in their recovery. So oftentimes, if somebody is not asked by their treatment team to discontinue exercise or to take a break from it, at least for a time, because it's not indicated for being helpful in their recovery, you're using it as a behavior. Some people use it as a way to purge, all of those things. We, a lot of the times, will recommend that people take a break from it, especially certain kinds of exercise. So if you're doing something extremely strenuous and exerting yourself really hard, we're definitely going to tell you to pause that. When people think about getting back to doing exercise again, I think that what I've seen in my practice is that most people feel a really big push to get back to it quite quickly. And I want to validate for people, I can really empathize with when you have that feeling in your body of just being restless and really wanting to move your body. And in general, as you work through the recovery process, that's a helpful internal cue to listen to, that your body is asking for you to move it. However, there are some times where even if you're starting to feel that way or you're feeling restless, sometimes your treatment team will ask you to not engage in exercise yet or to start with a different kind of exercise. Particularly if compulsive overexercise is a part of your eating disorder, this is going to be something where I think most people really feel that desire to get back to exercising and exercising strenuously much, much, much too quickly. So my first major kind of tip is not to rush it, to try to allow yourself to take the time that you need to slow down or even take a break from any kind of formal exercise and kind of get the eating disorder in a place where you feel like you're able to challenge it a little bit more. Exercise in general is something that is great for people, but when you have an eating disorder, it can be extremely, extremely triggering and it can be a behavior. I also have people that I work with question, what is the urgency? So I get it. When your body is feeling restless and you want to move it, I can understand why that's pushing you toward exercise. But as I've explored with my clients, a lot of them will report too that there's kind of just this internalized pressure or expectation to exercise, that it's kind of part of what they've built up in their minds as how life, quote, should be. And they have all these shoulds around exercise, you know, like healthy people do all these certain things, which again, who are healthy people? What does that even mean? I would also challenge you to question, where is the urgency and that pressure to exercise coming from if you're feeling that? If it's beyond just like that general, my body feels kind of restless, but you're thinking about it in like this way of, I should, exercise is good, I should do this good thing. People who are healthy do this. Certainly people have fears around gaining weight or their shape changing in any way because our culture is totally diet culture and toxic and fat phobic to all kinds of people. So I think that there's a lot of really good work that people can do, especially in therapy, on understanding what in the past has motivated your exercise. If it's been all about losing weight and changing the shape of your body in order to, for sure, in part, avoid being discriminated against and feeling more valuable as you become smaller, that is something that is going to have to get shifted in your recovery. And we want to help people work toward moving their bodies and engaging in exercise for reasons other than wanting to lose weight. I also want to say, I understand too that there are people for whom losing weight means something else, not just additionally being seen as more attractive or valuable and avoiding the experience of stigma and discrimination, which are all very valid and real. But also, you know, if you're non-binary or you identify as trans and you are trying to change the weight or shape of your body because that helps you to feel less dysphoria, I hear you, I get that. And that's an additional layer to work on with your treatment team too, which is, how can you, when you're ready, engage in exercise in a way that feels affirming in general to you without it becoming something that your eating disorder co-opts for its own purposes. So I would also have you think about, and I always tell clients this, and I think the first few times I talk to people about this, they usually look at me like, I don't know, like I have three eyeballs or something. But I always tell people to think about food and exercise as two completely separate domains. And I honestly can't remember if I've talked about this on the podcast or not, but I think about exercise for myself, being a recovered person, just being a person, as just one thing that I do to take good physical care of myself. That's the same thing with food. The way that I eat, I think about what do I need to nourish my body and what do I need to enjoy my experience of food and living. And those two things, to me, are not interconnected. Exercise and food, it is not a transactional relationship. So let me break that down for you. So if I eat something that is more calorically dense that most people's eating disorders would have a problem with, I don't have that connection of, oh, well, I'll need to exercise more to compensate for that. It's not a transaction. If I eat something that's less calorically dense, I don't get to exercise less, or I don't have any desire to exercise less, because it's not about this caloric exchange. So I think of them as two separate things. I eat in a way that brings me pleasure and satisfaction, but also nourishes what my body needs. Separately, completely separately, I also engage in movement and exercise routinely because it's a good thing that is helpful to my body that is no longer triggering or damaging to me in any way. This is totally different than what diet culture teaches us, which is that everything is transactional. So everything that you eat needs to be burned up completely or burned up partially and compensated for. And how much you exercise dictates how much you eat, and how much you eat dictates how much you exercise. In recovery, I would really encourage you to start thinking about those things as two separate, completely different domains that don't even interact with each other. Because we all need to eat in a way that's nourishing enough on an ongoing basis to take good care of our bodies. We also all need to move in ways that are nourishing and helpful to our bodies that aren't self-destructive and that bring us joy and satisfaction as well. Just thinking about those two things as not at all related. I exercise on an ongoing basis because it's one way of taking care of my body. I eat in a way that's nourishing and satisfying and pleasurable because that's also nourishing to my body too. We've got to get rid of this idea of trying to make up for what you ate with exercise and to discontinue exercising more so that you can eat more. They're not the same. They're not related. You should be eating in ways that are nourishing to your physical health and exercising in ways that are nourishing to your physical health, both on an ongoing basis, irrespective of what is going on with either of those, which I know it's kind of hard to break that, but I would definitely encourage you to write about this, journal about this, talk with friends in recovery about this, certainly talk with your treatment team about this. We want to have your relationship with food be something that's satisfying and also brings you health in the same way that we do with exercise, and not to have those two tied up in each other so that you're trying to undo with food with exercise and vice versa. It just is not helpful that way. And subsequently, diet culture and the eating disorder will latch onto this diet culture mentality that the only good benefit about exercise is that it's about changing your weight or your shape, which is certainly not the case. There are lots of reasons to move your body. That's just the predominant one that gets blasted in our diet-obsessed culture. I would say that's another reason to be thinking about the way that you eat as separate from exercise. They don't have anything to do with each other, and they don't have to in your recovery, certainly. I wanted to also talk about the idea of intuitive eating and how that applies to the idea of intuitive movement or exercise. So firstly, kind of like I said in the beginning of the episode, I would think about movement as maybe broader, and exercise, I guess I would use that maybe more specifically if I'm like physically exerting myself a little bit more. And please keep in mind, like, I'm talking about this from the perspective of one, someone who's recovered, who like does not have an abusive relationship with exercise anymore. And two, somebody who treats eating disorders. So if you ever hear me say exercise or exertion, just know that that's totally within the normal bounds. Like, I'm never going to recommend that somebody do something harmful to themselves. And I don't do exercise that's harmful to myself. And if you really hate the term exercise, then think about it as movement, if that fits better for you. Just do what you need to do. But one of the main takeaways, I think, of intuitive eating is that intuitive eating shifts you from these external cues that we get from diet culture about how we're to eat, like food rules or what time we should eat, or there are rules about how much quantity of a certain food we can eat. It shifts you away from that to focusing instead on internal cues. So cues that come from within you, like how hungry are you at a given moment? How full are you? How satisfied are you? And listening to your body. So intuitive eating really, really respects that the body is wise, and intuitive eating enhances the mind-body connection. If we map that concept on to intuitive movement, we would be going after the same sorts of things. So instead of focusing on external cues for what our relationship with movement and exercise is supposed to be, things such as I should be doing this type of exercise versus that one, I should be doing it for this long or working out this hard, and I really hate the phrase working out, but I couldn't think of how else to say that, or I need to be burning X number of calories and that sort of thing. Those are all external cues. If we shift over and we think about movement as intuitive, just like eating can be, we can think about how could we make that about our mind-body connection? How can you make that about listening to your body to guide you on what to do with movement? Your eating disorder, of course, is only going to think about the things that are focused on weight loss, modifying your shape, burning calories. It is not respectful of when your body has limitations or you need to stop, take a break, take a rest, slow down, pace yourself, all of those things. Your eating disorder doesn't care. I'm sure many of you listening know that experientially to be true, that the eating disorder will just tell you, like, keep going, irrespective of what your body is giving you feedback on. So when we think about internal cues, what are some internal cues that you could get from movement? So first of all, internally, you may have a sense of what types of exercise or movements are more appealing to you than others. So if you removed the idea of weight or caloric burn from the equation, and instead you think about what things do you want to do just to move your body without having this expectation that you have to really make up for what you ate or all those ridiculous things that eating disorders say, what might you want to do? What would sound really appealing? Just like with intuitive eating, what would be the most satisfying? What kinds of movement can bring you joy? So it may shift from something where you are doing extremely high intensity exercise in a gym on a machine that potentially you don't even like, or maybe feels like self-harm to you, to freeing yourself up and doing something else. Maybe you turn some music on and dance in your kitchen every morning. Maybe it means that you go on a walk with your pup. Maybe it means that something really gentle feels good to you, like stretching or something that's a very mindful practice. If you remove that nasty diet culture, eating disordered perspective on things about what you, quote, should be doing, it really opens up the possibility of you actually listening to your body. And a lot of the times in recovery, when people start listening to their body, when they're doing exercise or movement in a way that the eating disorder is dictating, they can feel how awful it actually feels. In all likelihood, your eating disorder is pushing you far beyond what your body is asking for. I think eating disorders totally kill the joy of any kind of movement or exercise. So again, going back to this concept of listening to internal cues versus external cues, it's helpful as well to explore in therapy or in a journal or with a friend where diet culture has influenced your ideas about what exercise and movement should be. What are the ideas exactly? Like, I always ask people, what are the hidden expectations in your mind? Because I think that a lot of the times we're doing things in a way to live up to these expectations of ourselves that perhaps we haven't even named. Like, you might even, thinking about it right now, have an idea of how much you're supposed to be moving, what your body is supposed to be like, all of these outside metrics and numbers that you're supposed to be meeting. And part of the really good work of making movement and exercise more intuitive is moving toward listening to things and respecting your internal cues versus these external cues or expectations that we have of ourselves that are largely from diet culture, which is toxic and harmful to us. Another point I want to make is that with exercise, it's extremely, extremely helpful to work with a team. So if you do not already have a treatment team, I would highly encourage you to connect with one. I know that that can be very difficult for people for a number of reasons, including where you're at. But if at all possible, please, please, please work with a team. If using exercise as a way to lose weight has been a part of your disorder, if using exercise in a compulsive way or as an OCD behavior for you has been a problem, you definitely need to be speaking with a professional about this. And again, a lot of the times, they may advise you that you need to stop that for a while or completely switch types of exercise, but a lot of the time we just recommend a complete stop. So in working on and integrating movement and exercise in your recovery, I think it is really helpful to have a third party to bounce these ideas off of so that you can have a safe space to kind of check what is motivating the exercise. We really want to help you recover from that idea that exercise is compensatory for what you ate and that exercise is about losing weight always and keeping yourself small, literally and figuratively. When people are ready to reintegrate exercise or change up their exercise after they've talked about it, they've thought about it, they've checked in with themselves, they've checked in with a treatment team, one thing that I would encourage is to start gentle and don't exert yourself too much. So not only have I seen so many people really eager to get back to exercise quickly and perhaps prematurely, I would say, which again, I empathize with, but I also see people going back to or wanting to go back to forms of exercise that I think are really intense. I want to specify here, I don't think that there's anything objectively wrong with exerting your body. And there are certainly lots of reasons to do that. I mean, athletes do that professionally. However, if you are in a place where you're working on recovering from an eating disorder, you do not want to go back into really hard, strenuous, severe exercise. It's just not going to be helpful. It's going to be super, super, super triggering to you. And to be honest, having an eating disorder completely disrupts, I think, your body's ability to have trust with you, that mind-body connection. It doesn't trust you. You've probably worked it into the ground with exercise. Part of what you're recovering while you're working on this stuff in therapy and with your team is about being able to trust yourself to take care of your body in a really respectful way again, instead of abusing it or punishing it with exercise. Another thing that you can do is to, on your own and with your team, go through and take some good, solid time and identify what triggers you have for going back into diet mentality or weight loss mentality with exercise. So what is triggering that in exercise? Is it because you have a friend and you're comparing bodies? Is it because you're seeing commercials that are portraying completely unrealistic bodies and expectations for what exercise and movement is supposed to be? Is it because you feel uncomfortable in your body at this point in recovery or in general? Is it because your body is experiencing and you are stigma and discrimination and pressure to change it? Is it that you don't feel unsafe in your body? Additionally, thinking about things about the exercise itself that are triggering. Are you going to a gym or an exercise facility where there are mirrors everywhere and that's not helpful to you? Are you going somewhere where there is a scale in the gym and you know that you're going to feel tempted to weigh yourself or you do actually weigh yourself? These are all really good things to think about and work through that are considerations for how and when to reintegrate exercise and movement. So for sure, if you're somebody who's struggled with exerting yourself too much, not listening to your body, using exercise as a way of punishing yourself, going to a gym that has things that are far too strenuous for what your body is asking for, and then afterward at that same gym you weigh yourself, don't go back to that gym and do the same exercise in the same way. It doesn't sound like it's going to be helpful. It's going to be really, really triggering because you're going right back to what you did. And you're expecting yourself to feel differently about this form of exercise, but really, you're going to be bringing up a bunch of the same old feelings. So thinking about what triggers you to get back into weight loss mentality of how you can burn all those calories off and change the shape and size of your body. And if there are things about the exercise itself that you may be pursuing that are triggering. One thing that can help is getting support and exercising with other people, or maybe even doing some exercise with a pet or movement with a pet, because most of us don't abuse exercise in front of other people. I mean, the caveat to that, of course, is I think that there are certainly group fitness classes that when I hear my clients describe them to me, I'm just like, oh no, that sounds really triggering and negative and totally based in diet culture. For example, when you're thinking about how can you get support, all right, maybe you're at a place in your recovery where you've come to the conclusion and you've talked about it collaboratively with your team where you're thinking, okay, maybe I want to try to move my body a little bit more. I'm going to try to do this from this place of connecting with my body instead of it being just a vehicle for losing weight. One thing that you can do is ask a friend to go on a walk with you, something that's not strenuous, something like that. Take your dog out on a walk if you have one, you know, something that's going to just, first of all, make the activity more enjoyable and make it easier for you to be present, but also that will help you to not take the exercise too far. So if you're out with your pup, hopefully you're not overdoing it with the poor animal when they get tired and hot and need to go home and get some water and lay down. And also, hopefully you're not doing that with a friend. Obviously, you can consider what kinds of friends would be best to go do this exercise with. Maybe you don't ask your friend who potentially has a really extreme relationship with exercise too. So getting support can be really helpful. Another thing that you can do is to switch it up, which is to try some form of exercise or movement that you haven't done in the past. So I know that there are all kinds of reasons why people may or may not go to a gym, and that by going to a gym or a recreation center or fitness classes, you have to have a lot of resources and privilege to be able to do that anyway. But this is one case where you may think about, if you do go to somewhere like that, can you do something different? Or maybe you don't need to go back to a gym at all. If all of your compulsive, self-harming, abusive behavior with exercise to yourself happened in a gym, maybe you consider not going back to the gym for a while and you figure out how to do movement in other ways outside of a facility like that that are helpful. There are all kinds of things. I would also encourage you to think about the idea of moving your body more broadly. So when you're at work and you're sitting at your desk for hours and hours and hours, if you get up and walk down the hall, great, count that as movement. It's not the same as when you think about it from that weight loss mentality of it's got to be more extreme than that. But actually, that is enough. Those are the sort of things that are really helpful in the long run when they add up to thinking about moving our body routinely as a way to help our health. Again, in ways that your body is able to and ways that you enjoy doing. Also, there may be different types of exercise that you've never tried out. And I think that this can definitely happen because when you're thinking about things from the weight loss only perspective, a lot of the times all it's about is how can you burn the max number of calories possible, or how can you do the most strenuous exercise? Like, it's always about getting to the most extreme form of anything. But maybe you want to do some sort of movement or exercise because it looks fun. Any kind of dance-based thing. Obviously, if dance was a problem for you, this does not apply. Any kind of fun thing that you can do with another person. Maybe you want to do a form of movement or exercise that's more peaceful or mindful. I don't think that there's any form of exercise that's completely free of being co-opted by diet culture. I just don't think that that's possible. Like, I wanted to give the example of yoga can be a good practice for people. Also, people totally use yoga in unhealthy ways. So it's not about the exercise itself, but thinking about if there is a form of exercise or movement that you haven't tried that maybe you're interested in doing because you know that going back to whatever you were doing before is not going to be helpful, expanding your options. There are lots of ways to move your body and lots of things that you can do to decrease the amount of time that you're sedentary without it being all about weight loss. Another thing that I want to point out is it's really helpful to avoid numbers. So maybe trying a form of exercise or movement where you don't know the estimated number of calories burned, like you have no idea. that actually can be incredibly helpful because this is breaking that connection between that transactional relationship of I have to exercise this much in order to burn off calories from food I ate. Another way to avoid numbers is if you are going to a gym and you do decide to use a machine or something like that, cover the monitor where it tells you all of those objective numbers, like, I don't know, distance or calories or whatever sort of things they keep track of. I don't particularly love those, so I don't use them hardly ever. But if that's your jam and it's something that you can do in recovery and is not triggering to you, it seems like that would be harder to make it less triggering. Then cover the monitor. Use a towel at the gym to cover it up. Cover it with like a non-weight loss magazine that you might be reading, maybe like the news, although even the general news is like so freaking fat phobic some days I can't even stand it. And lastly, another way to avoid numbers, ditch your Fitbit and ditch those apps on your Apple Watch. Disclaimer, I don't have an Apple Watch. I'm sure I would destroy it. And also, I don't want notifications on my wrist. But if I did, like, however you need to do it, turn those functions on Apple Watch off. That's totally not necessary for having a healthy relationship with movement and exercise. It only puts people back into this numbers, diet mentality, weight loss frame of mind. Also on Apple Watch and Fitbit and I don't know, whatever other forms of fitness monitors there are out there. A lot of them have functions. I think maybe most of them have functions where you can compete with other people. Why is that necessary? I legit don't understand that. If you're thinking about moving your body as much as you can in ways that are helpful to you as a routine way of taking care of yourself, you do not need to know how much the other person on this app that you're competing with is doing. There's no purpose for that. And in recovery, that sounds triggering as hell. That sounds totally ridiculous. Everybody knows eating disorders can bring out our competitiveness in a completely self-destructive form. It just continues to blow my mind. Like, why is that a thing? Why is that necessary? To me, the answer is it's not necessary. So ditch that. You do not need that. You just think about how do you routinely move your body in ways that bring you joy and satisfaction. I want to point out a couple of things that will differentiate between a healthy relationship with movement and exercise versus one that is less healthy or unhealthy, even maybe even disordered. I'm actually taking this out of the Intuitive Eating Workbook by Elise Resch and Evelyn Triboli. I would highly recommend that if that's appropriate for you in your recovery. This is out of their chapter, Principle 9 is about exercise. And they talk about some things as being indicative of helpful exercise. I actually cited a research study in here where I believe this list is coming from. But here's what they categorize as some signs that your relationship with exercise is mindful and healthy, is that exercise rejuvenates rather than exhausts or depletes. It enhances the mind-body connection. It alleviates stress rather than amplifies it. And it provides genuine enjoyment and pleasure. I'm going to read those again. It rejuvenates rather than exhausts or depletes. It enhances the mind-body connection. It alleviates stress rather than amplifies stress. And it provides genuine enjoyment and pleasure. Those are all things that in your recovery process, you can work on. You can increase enjoyment and pleasure. You can seek out types of movement and exercise that are rejuvenating and energize you rather than totally wipe you out and deplete you. All of this can enhance your connection between your body using those internal cues versus external cues. So again, as you're working on this in recovery, thinking about all of these concepts, running it past your treatment team, seeking counsel and making sure that you have eyes on, that way the eating disorder isn't sneaking in there because it definitely does that with eating disorders. One last tip that I want to plug for reintegrating movement and exercise in your recovery process is supporting Health at Every Size, HAES, and or fat positive organizations, gyms, dance organizations, clubs, any of those sort of things. If you have any of those in your area, I would highly recommend seeking out doing movement or exercise in those sort of spaces that are mindful and aware and affirming and are not coming from a place of diet culture and desire for weight loss versus what we have at large, which is totally toxic, completely disconnected from our bodies, and is driven by this idea that everybody's body needs to be smaller. So in wrapping up, of course, those are not completely comprehensive ideas about recommendations for exercise and movement. They may not apply to every single person. You really need to think about this in the context of your own recovery and definitely consult with your treatment team. Do not ever follow the advice of this podcast or anything I say on this podcast if it contradicts what your treatment team is telling you. And just again, thinking about reclaiming, recovering this way, this idea of moving your body or engaging in exercise in a way that is not related to weight, to shape, with having any kind of deficit about how your body is, and doing it instead as an ongoing routine way that you take good physical care of yourself in the ways that your body is able to. So that is all for now. Those are my thoughts on exercise and movement, getting that back as an intuitive process rather than as something that's dictated by external toxic diet culture cues.
Thanks for joining me for another episode. Let's keep in touch. You can find all the information you need about the podcast at eatingdisorderrecoverypodcast.com, including full podcast episodes and links to all of our social media sites. You can join our Facebook group for the podcast by searching Eating Disorder Recovery Podcast on Facebook. This is a closed group for listeners of the podcast looking to connect, share resources, and get involved in a pro-recovery community. Don't forget to subscribe to the podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, SoundCloud, or YouTube. Please leave us a review and let us know how we're doing. Talk to you next time on the Eating Disorder Recovery Podcast.